Tonight, Croydon Council wants its cash back. The busted borough is trying to get a £400,000 payoff back from its former boss.
We want to do everything we possibly can to hold those to account who have financially ruined Croydon and bankrupted our borough twice, three times over.
Also ahead, two men are cleared in the plot to rob Amir Khan of his designer watch at gunpoint.
And there is his immortal moment.
After his landmark penalty, we hear from Harry Kane's youngest fans who are inspired to do the same. And
if there's any justice in the world, I would be your man. You would be my girl.
Friday treat. Singer Lamar is back. He'll be here for a chat about his new music. Good evening. Last night, we briefly told you about Croydon Council and how their failures and financial mismanagement will be referred to the police. The borough famously went bust in 2020 and their former chief executive, Joe Negrini, was given a settlement of £437,000 when she was laid off. Well, now the council want to balance their broken books and will be seeking legal action against the previous administration, which includes trying to get that payoff back. Here's our senior correspondent, Ronke Phillips.
Former chief executive Joe Negrini left Croydon Council 3 years ago, and she went with a golden handshake of almost £500,000. But at a meeting last night, committee members decided she should pay the money back and they're going to take legal action to recover as much of the settlement as possible.
We want to do everything we possibly can to hold those to account who have financially ruined Croydon and bankrupted our borough twice, three times over. So we will do everything we legally can to try and recapture as much money as we possibly can from the former chief executive.
The amount of money Croydon owes is frankly staggering. They have a £1.6 billion debt profile with only £300 million of assets. So even if they sold everything they own, they have no way of paying the debt off. The move comes more than 2 years since a report into the council's bungled £70 million refurbishment of Fairfield Halls, £30 million on buying Croydon Park Hotel, and £250 million lent to property company Brick by Brick.
We feel like we are forking a bill for something that, you know, shouldn't have never happened.
Local business owners who've been left paying sky-high rates and council tax bills are behind the council's decision to recover the settlement payment from Croydon's former CEO.
If money's been mismanaged, just like any other area, I think definitely why not investigate it?
I'm renting from council. And they don't help me.
So if they get this money back, you think at least they're doing something now?
Of course, they have to do.
It's the principal that she shouldn't have taken that payment.
Croydon's new administration also plans to report what it's calling failures and mismanagement to the Metropolitan Police. They're claiming misconduct in public office and a lack of governance. And academics specialising in local government agree there needs to be more accountability.
I think people in Croydon will rightly feel that they've been let down. And even if people were held to account, the money won't be got back. I mean, you know, the huge sum of money is so large that even if a tiny amount of it got back, the debt is so great, the government's going to have to help Croydon.
Chasing Joe Negrini for part of her settlement may end up costing the council more money than it manages to recover. They plan to ask the government to write off some of the debt, but in the end, it will be the local taxpayer who will foot the bill. Ronke Phillips, ITV News.
Next, a Metropolitan Police constable who worked as a Safer Schools officer in Enfield has been jailed for 5 years after admitting having sexual activity with a young girl. 22-year-old Hussein Shihab was caught when concerns were raised by the police back in July 2021. Well, Callum Watkinson is at Wood Green Crown Court. Callum, what's been said today?
Well, this goes back to 2019. This man, Hussein Shihab, met this girl online. She was 14, he was 18. He told her, though, that he was 16, and he persuaded her to engage in sexual activity over a period of about 6 months. some of which he recorded on his mobile phone. He took a number of other explicit stills of her as well, and he shared some of this stuff with other people. She trusted you, a judge told him today, and she believed that you loved her, and he described the nature of this contact between them as manipulative and bullying. And now Chahab later became a probationary police officer with the Metropolitan Police, and it was after that that someone made them aware of this sexual contact with a minor. He was arrested, his devices were seized and searched, and on those devices the police found hundreds of other images of children, some of those depicting abuse and rape. Now, all of this led to 8 charges, child sex offence charges in total, all of which he pleaded guilty to at a hearing in January. And today he was sentenced to a total of 5 years for those offences. And now, you are right to say that he was a safer schools officer for a time. The judge went out of his way to point out today, though, that was simply as part of the rota for a probationary officer. There was no suggestion that he had deliberately placed himself in that role to gain access to children, or the judge said that he had involved any of the children at that school in his offending. The offending was going on while he was working at the school, though, and the judge described that as alarming.
OK, Callum, thanks very much indeed. To other news now, and security guards at Heathrow Airport will go ahead with a strike over Easter after talks failed. Unite members will take part in a 10-day walkout, which the airport described as unnecessary. The airport says it offered a 10% pay increase already and has contingency plans to keep the airport operating normally. The owner of a dog that attacked 2 police horses yesterday in East London has told a national newspaper that it wasn't the dog's fault. Hakan Niyazi's American bulldog named Coco inflicted multiple injuries on the horses in a 5-minute attack in Victoria Park. Coco was seized by police after the incident. And the reality of the London rental market was seen this week with a video of 50 families queuing to view a house in East London going viral. Renters in the capital saw prices increase by 12% over the last year, according to government figures. But first, 2 men who were accused of being spotters while Amir Khan was robbed at gunpoint have been cleared this afternoon. The former world boxing champion was targeted as he left a restaurant with his wife in Leighton last year and said the experience had made him scared to walk around the capital. Jay Akbar has the story.
When a smiling Amir Khan left dinner with his family this night last April, he couldn't have predicted the danger that awaited outside. The champion boxer had barely stepped foot outside when a man pulled a gun on him. In a robbery which lasted just seconds, Khan's luxury watch, worth £72,000, was gone with his robbers into the East London night.
I acknowledge the trauma that the family and Mr. Khan would have suffered from this. We did arrest 4 people as a result of tenacious inquiries, extensive CCTV and then subsequently telephone inquiries, which led to this prosecution and conviction of 2 of the 4 people that we arrested.
The 2 convicted were gunman Dante Campbell on the left and driver Ahmed Banner. The other 2 defendants were today cleared of acting as spotters in that robbery. Ismail Mohammed and Nurul Amin were accused of dining at the Sahara Grill restaurant to keep track of Mr. Khan's movements. Today, Mohammed's lawyer said they were legitimately out for dinner, and you can see that on CCTV, before Amin's added, if they were involved, they'd be the worst spotters in the world. Outside court today, both men thanked their legal team for helping clear their names. There was a huge rise in high-value watch theft in 2022, with Khan's one of 621 stolen between January and July last year. The 2 men convicted of stealing his will be sentenced at a later date. Jay Akbar, ITV News.
Well, still to come, we'll have the full weekend weather forecast plus. Singer Lamar is back from an 11-year break and will be telling me all about his new music. And we meet the little trooper who's been honoured for her courage while her dad has been serving in the army. It was a moment of absolute glory for Tottenham's Harry Kane last night as he became England's all-time leading goalscorer. It was his penalty which helped England to a 2-1 win over Italy in Naples, overtaking Wayne Rooney's record with a 54th goal. Well, Kane's historic performance will now surely inspire his youngest fans. We sent Anna Geary down to his old school in Chingford to ask them what they thought.
The excitement was shared by football mad year sixes at the primary school Kane went to in Chingford.
It makes me feel like I want to tell other people because I'm going to a secondary school as well.
He's one of the best players in the world, also England's top goal scorer.
And what's it like going to the same school as where he went?
I think my friend there, me and him will probably follow in his footsteps and try to do better, maybe.
I love it, fighting talk.
I'm really proud to say, like, Harry Kane's come to my school and he knows about my school, he cares about it.
I think that Harry Kane played well. I'm really happy that he's the top goal scorer for England and he broke a record again.
One of the best players in England's history.
What does that make you think about sort of coming to this school?
Well, maybe following his footsteps.
So reliable from the spot. And the tears have already started to flow.
With that in mind, Julie, formerly Harry's teaching assistant in primary school, was a tense viewer yesterday.
I couldn't watch personally. I listened to it from my husband's. I watched behind my eyes and then I watched the replay. And it was emotional because we are, apart from loving the England team, we are Spurs anyway, all of my family. He held himself well and he deserves it. He was a lovely boy.
A lovely boy that Julie says always had a ball at his foot. But little did anyone know then that the East Londoner was laying the groundwork to write his name into the history books. Anna Geary, ITV News.
Brian Cox, who plays Logan Roy in the drama Succession, rang the opening bell at the London Stock Exchange this morning. It's ahead of the final season of the hit drama released next week. He said being in the capital's financial heart was extraordinary.
When we come out, we saw people down there, and it shifted. The energy shifted in a way, and I thought, oh, my God, this is extraordinary. And it is extraordinary. It's an extraordinary place. And especially the setting around, you know, St. Paul's, the Old Bailey. There is something that finally seeps through to you, which is, really? Am I doing this? Wow. God, I never thought I'd do it in a million years.
Next, the police are, of course, well used to walking the beat. But for one former Essex detective, his new patrol has extra resonance. Bob Craven, who's 76, is walking up and down Southend Pier every week to help fundraise for mental health charities after his own struggles. But it's not only cash the ex-investigator is hoping to raise, but awareness too. Callum Fairhurst has been to meet him.
Hello, thank you. Thank you for coming. Thank you. Hello, thank you for coming.
Bob's walking, or according to him, plodding, along Southend Pier. At 76 years young, with chronic asthma and a heart condition, the 2.6-mile round journey is tough. Even more impressively, he's doing it every week for 15 weeks to raise money.
It might be absolutely pelting with rain, horizontal sleet and snow, but you're out here. What you achieve after coming to the pier and enjoying the peace and quiet and the scenery, you could see it all behind us. It is wonderful.
As an undercover police officer, he was shot at, beaten up and even thrown off a balcony. It's left him struggling with PTSD. These walks are his safe space. Each walk starts with a talk, telling people about his struggles and pointing to help.
I know that I've won several battles and I think other people can benefit from the experience that I've had. Lots of organisations and charities and therapists are there and I'm hoping to be able to signpost these people through the topics I'm doing to enable them to prevent themselves from going down the ultimate route.
His granddaughter, Hallie, is full of admiration.
Really, really proud.
I just can't believe he's been doing it. Like, it's such an inspiration for me and for all my friends know about it, and they're just thinking he's an absolute trooper.
Walking with Bob down the pier, it's hard to convey the joy he radiates. Facing dark days himself, Bob brings so much light to others struggling. So I'll leave the final message to him.
Even though you feel bad and there are really, really dark times, you can be happy. You can really smile at adversity. Stay calm, stay positive, and look to the future.
Callum Fairhurst reporting there. Now, let's go to a star from Tottenham, and our guest tonight has had an 11-year break from music, but after winning two Brit Awards following his stint on Fame Academy, he needs very little introduction.
Girl, I tried and tried a million times to get you off my mind. It's not that easy. If there's any justice in the world, I would be your man. Where do I go? What do? I can't deny I still feel something. And girl, I will.
Well, I'm so happy to say that Singer Lamar joins me now. You're back!
Yeah.
And you've got some new material.
I do. I've got some new material. It was funny seeing all those videos again. It's funny how music can take you back to a certain time or place. I was in LA for a lot of those and in New York as well. So, yeah, it's crazy seeing those videos.
Oh, yeah. You've been everywhere. Well, let's have a listen now to your new music. This track is called Future Love. Let's have a listen. Is that a kind of more mature Lamar, would you say, or...?
Yeah, do you know, I think time has allowed me to evolve as a writer, as a singer, as a performer. That song is for anyone who's flirting with love. You know, they've found someone that they think could be the one and, you know, they're trying to find the words to let them know.
Are you still flirting with love?
Am I still flirting with love? I'm fully in love. Fully in love with the family, yes.
That's brilliant. Now, look, it's your 20-year anniversary in the music industry this year. Do you think you feel more fear releasing this new material than you did back in the day when you started with Fame Academy?
Yeah, do you know what? Back in the day, I was releasing an album every single year. So, I don't know, I think naturally you just feel more in touch with your fans, with the audience. An 11-year break from releasing new music definitely does bring a new level of nerves, you know. So I was definitely a bit apprehensive releasing this album, but finally I'm happy today. It's out, Page in My Heart, and it's for the people to have a listen and decide what it means to them.
Oh, yeah, that's brilliant. And I don't know a single person who doesn't know or love your music. So why did you stop 11 years ago?
Do you know what? I think sometimes with anything, even if you love it, you can get a little bit burnt out. You know, doing the same thing for a long time. So I decided to keep on writing music, but for other projects as well. So I was writing for other artists, for a bit of TV as well. Also, though, I did some acting in that time. I did a movie with Jamelia and the talented family of children that we worked with as well. The movie was called Little Darlings. Also did a podcast as well. And yeah, a lot of writing. But while you're writing, every so often, I stumbled across a song that I thought, you know, I think this one's a keeper. Mm. And eventually you end up with a body of work that's ready to release, yeah.
Amazing. And you've been busy, as you've just said, over these 11 years. I mean, you've been performing as well. You haven't exactly gone away, have you?
No, I've been doing performances. I mean, a few years ago, I released an album called The Letter, but that was an album of covers. So it was just soulful covers. But I hadn't released any new material in a while. And a lot of fans, very dedicated, come to shows and ask me, look, when's some new stuff, though? We love the old stuff, but can we just hear something new? Yeah. So I thought, you know what, this year will be a good time, 20 years since the first album, and, come with a new body of work and maybe do one or two shows as well.
That's brilliant. Is there going to be a chance for people to hear this new music? You got some performances coming up?
Yes, I do. On April the 27th, I'm going to be in Manchester O2 Ritz. That's going to be cool. And then April the 28th, I'll be at Indigo at the O2 in London. So really looking forward to those old shows. I'll be there with my live band, going to do a bit of reminiscing, and obviously one or two tracks from this new album as well.
Well, that's going to be brilliant. Do you think you're going to feel nervous about that?
I know that I'm going to feel nervous. I'm going to be 100% nervous. But, you know, there's a saying that I love. Feel the fear and do it anyway. If you don't feel a little bit of fear, then maybe you don't care enough. So definitely I'm going to be nervous. But I'm sure once I step out and the crowd's there, I'll give it 100%.
Yeah. We were hearing about Harry Kane recently. I know you are a bit of a Spurs fan.
Yeah.
Not a massive Spurs fan.
No,
but are you pleased with what he managed to achieve last night?
Of course. Of course. Records are there to be broken. Some seem impossible. Obviously, Rooney's a legend. But, yeah, Kane, I think with the rate that he was scoring goals, I think it was always inevitable. But, yeah, congratulations.
He's good. Oh, well, best of luck with your new album and everything else you got coming up.
Thank you very much.
Thanks very much indeed. Now, being a young child with a parent in the military can be extremely difficult. And for 10-year-old Eva May Little from Woolwich, it has meant moving schools five times to places like Germany, Cyprus and Wales while her father served in the army. Now, the 10-year-old has been honoured by the children's charity Little Troopers for how she's been dealing with it all while not being well herself. Antoine Allen's been to meet her.
Eva May, you've won this special award. It's a Little Trooper of the Month award, and it's to recognise how brave, special and inspirational you really are.
At just 10 years old, Eva May has lived around Europe. Her resilience and positive attitude to her life as the daughter of a soldier earned her this medal.
Eva May has been very brave and very resilient.
Eva May's father is away with the British Army, helping train Ukrainian fighters. But today he made the time to congratulate his daughter.
You've got that medal because everything you've gone through, and every time Daddy has to move and you have to move school, you've done it really well, darling, OK?
Thank you, Dad.
Daddy loves you.
Eva May was nominated for this award by her proud mother.
This medal is exactly the same as what Daddy gets, isn't it?
Yeah. First, I didn't believe what my mum was saying until she showed me that I've won, and I really appreciate that I had won because I went against a lot of people in this world.
During her short life, Eva May has already lived in four countries.
Where have you lived in the world?
I've lived in Germany, two different places in Germany. I've lived in Cyprus and I have lived in Wales.
What was it like living in all those places?
Cyprus is probably one of my favourites because it had water parks and stuff.
Eva May balances moving schools and having to make new friends with a health condition that causes her bouts of acute pain. Eva's mum wants her to be an inspiration to other children.
Not just to show Eva how special she is, but just to show all military children across the board how special they really are and how difficult our lives at times can be, especially when their dads are away missing major events.
Eva May's teacher at Christchurch C of E Primary School believes all military children deserve praise for overcoming the challenges of life with a parent in the forces.
I know many adults that could cope with that, so the fact that children have to cope with that at a young age is amazing. I think they do an amazing job in supporting their parents and helping them to cope.
Eva May hopes to one day follow in her dad's footsteps, so this could be the first medal of many. Antoine Allen, ITV News.
Well, let's have a look at the main headlines in London this evening. Croydon Council wants a £400,000 payoff given to their former boss back. It comes as the borough tries to recover financially after going bust in 2020. And two men accused of being spotters while Amir Khan was robbed have been cleared. Well, the weather's certainly been confusing today, to say the least. After a sunny start, these were the scenes in Shepherd's Bush this lunchtime. But things brightened up again this afternoon in Russell Square. It's all over the place. So is this what we've got in store this spring? Here's Chris Page with the forecast.
Feels like home, whatever the weather. Valent Boilers and Heat Pumps sponsors ITV London Weekend Weather.
Hello there. Very good evening to you. Across much of the capital today, there was a lot of sunshine at first, but very quickly a scattering of showers pulled their way in from the southwest, and that's the same story through much of the weekend, really. Sunny spells, scattered showers, but it is actually going to turn a little bit cooler. We're going to see the showers tending to drift their way across much of the capital, a wetter start to the day as we go through Sunday morning, but this system soon clears towards the east, bringing something brighter through the afternoon. But you'll notice the blues never too far away, suggesting that colder air diving southwards through the second half of the weekend for all of us too. But back to the here and now, we still have a scattering of showers to contend with, but the showers are tending to fade away through the night. Still a bit of a breeze coming in from the southwest, but temperatures should hold up between 7 and 8 degrees Celsius as we start Saturday morning. Of course, where we've got the clear skies, it does mean there'll be some sunshine to start, similar to how it was this morning as well. But then we'll begin to see that cloud building, the showers pulling their way in as we go through the afternoon, one or two of those on the heavy side, and there could even be the odd rumble of thunder as well. Top temperatures through tomorrow, 13 to 14 degrees Celsius. And if you're in the sunshine out of the wind, it shouldn't feel too bad at all. As we go through the second half of the weekend, yes, there will be more cloud as we start Sunday morning with some outbreaks of rain tracking their way through. The colder air digs its way in behind, giving us a cooler feel to the day on Sunday. But that cooler air is only a small blip as actually the sunshine returns through Monday and into the new working week and those temperatures start to gradually recover. But don't forget that as we go through Sunday morning, the clocks go forward by 1 hour as we see the beginning of British summertime. That's it from me. Have a lovely weekend. Bye-bye.
Valent sponsors ITV London Weekend Weather.
Finally, if you've ever wondered what it might be like to be crowned king or queen, you now have the chance to get one step closer to that, but only if you're wearing socks. The treasured medieval flooring, the exact spot at Westminster Abbey where King Charles will be crowned, is going to be open to the public for the first time on the 15th of May, a week after the coronation. Well, that's it from us. Mary's here next with the ITV Evening News. But from me and the rest of the London team, thanks for watching. Bye-bye.